Chevre, how are you? I hope everyone is gesund, stark, und freilich, begashmus und beruchnis. Everyone is healthy, strong, and happy physically and spiritually. Today is Erev Chag HaSukkos, and today we will speak a thought for the festival. Before we begin, we will begin with a posik from the Rebbe's new kapitel, Kof Yates, posik Tzamach Vav. Tov tam vadas lamdeini ki v'mitzvesecho hemonti. This is where David HaMelech turns to Hashem and asks Hashem to teach me the goodness and wisdom of the Torah's reasons, for I believe in your commandments. So we once spoke about this pasuk before. It's really connected to another pasuk, l'chol tichler yisi keitz. But mitzvascha is beyond, as he says later on in this kapitel. So one way we could maybe interpret the pasuk tuv tam v'das is as follows: that a mitzvah is God Himself, is infinite, and that's what it means. Therefore, there is layers upon layers upon layers, never ending, in the depth and the profundity of aspects and understandings and reasons behind the mitzvah. And that's what the pasuk means. Tov tam v'das. Teach me the tov tam, more reasons, better reasons, and knowledge in your of your mitzvahs, of your commandments. Why? Ki b'mitzvesecha hemonti. I believe in them. Belief represents something which is not totally understood, something which remains always somewhat beyond. Is something you have to believe in, or else you know it. Why use the word belief? So belief means something which is always beyond you. And that's the idea of a mitzvah. No matter how much you unearth and you discover what the meaning and purpose of a particular mitzvah is, there's still more. Why? Because it's God Himself. And over here we come to something novel in Judaism, which is absolutely astonishing, and which no other religion discusses or could fathom. And it's a very, very broad issue. And the concept is the concept of mitzvahs maisis, the stress on the actual fulfillment of a mitzvah, putting on a pair of tefillin, shaking your lulav to the right, to the left, eating matzah. Those are all mitzvahs maisis, commandments that are connected to the physical world and to physical objects, which is also related to the other subject where Judaism is not a subject, but a way of life. So that itself is two concepts. There's one idea that Judaism is the totality of the person, eating, swimming, drinking, sleeping, from the cradle to the grave, as they say. Every single moment of a Jew's life is an avenue where he can connect to God, even in the mundane so-called. That's one idea. And the other idea, how could it be that it's this idea of eating a matzah, chewing and swallowing, and this is how you become connected to God? So this is a very broad subject. And this brings us to the holiday of Sukkos, which covers these ideas. What is the specialty, the uniqueness, and the message that we take from Sukkos for a whole year is that Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, we were more spiritual. Even though Rosh Hashanah, we eat and we have meals, but nevertheless, half a day we spend in the synagogue. It's a day of judgment. It's a day of serious introspection. So we're definitely getting more spiritual. Yom Kippur, we could say we actually go totally spiritual. Let's go spiritual. Let's get spiritual. That's what Yom Kippur is all about. We're like angels, no eating, and all the other physical restraints. That is the commandment of the day, order of the day for Yom Kippur. Comes along Sukkos, we say, Zman simchaseinu v'samachta b'chagecha. We're meant to live in our Sukkos as we live at home, eating, drinking. That becomes part of the mitzvah. Like the concept, b'chol d'rechecha deyu, in all your ways you should know, b'chol ma'secha yil shem shemayim, and all your actions should be for the sake of heaven. As the famous saying goes concerning the sukkah, I'm a gator in the sukkah, mit de blata von shtivel. The sukkah is a mitzvah which envelops you totally. even with the blood, even with the mud on your boots, the mud on your boots also gets surrounded by the sukkah. You go into the sukkah with the mud on your boots. That also becomes part of the mitzvah. So that's the contrast between sukkahs and Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur. Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur is more introspective, spiritual, abstract. Sukkahs is more physical, concrete, and real life living. But now let's get to the core of the issue. We talk about mitzvahs maisis. And this is also a very important message for sukkahs. And it's a subject which is very broad and could warrant a good long couple of lessons to elaborate. The first thing we have to understand is, what is a mitzvah? So let's take the mitzvah of kashrus, for example. We'll go over to a person and say, what's the idea of kashrus? Why do we have to eat kosher? One person will say, because it's good for your health. And it's true, when you keep the laws of Hashem, it's good for your health. Another person will come along and say, I'm speaking this very bekitzer, quickly. Another person will come along and say, it's good for your soul. You are what you eat. The nature of the animals that God made kosher are the ones which make you a more sensitive, caring person. So someone's going to say, it's not about helping you physically or making you a better person spiritually. It's a whole different idea. When you eat kosher, you the whole world on a cosmic level, there's Kabbalah levels that are happening from this world to that world in celestial beings. Then another person will come along and says, you all got it wrong. What is kashrut? What is kosher? It's the will of Hashem. Not because of a reason, not because of a logic, not because of an effect, not because of an impact. What's its greatest virtue? That it's God. And that when you fulfill this commandment, you become connected with God Himself. That's the greatest accomplishment. And for lack of a better word, that's the way I have to look at it. When you are shaking your lulav from the right to the left, or when you're sitting in the sukkah, you are now getting intimate with God on the deepest, deepest, deepest level. But then the question is, how could it be that I'm saying that the lulav is God DNA and the box of tefillin is God DNA when God is beyond infinite, if you could say such a word, as we'll soon explain. And a box is a box, it's limited. And the lulav is just a growth, a vegetation of this planet Earth. It's the most finite thing. How can you say God Himself is in that? And the answer to this question, Alter Rebbe explains in chapter 4 of the Holy Tanya. You have to see there, he asks this question. And basically the answer is that true infinity is not limited in spiritual. And therein lies the mystery of Judaism, which no other religion could grasp. You see, they see God as a more spiritual being. So therefore, how are you going to measure distance or closeness to God? Obviously, by becoming more spiritual, then you get closer to God, and by negating the physical. But what happens if you understand and you realize that God is not spiritual or physical? He is what He is. That's it. So then how do we become closer or more distant from God? The answer is, according to what He decides. If He, Hashem, would have decided that if you stand on your head and spit nickels, that would be a mitzvah, and that would make you close to Him, then that would be a mitzvah, and that's how you get closer to Him. Now, obviously, kashrus works on every level. Since something is truly infinite, magical, it works on every single level you could imagine, and even more than you could imagine. So the mitzvah is right and correct and perfect on every single level. But the greatest, greatest, supreme, ultimate, unbelievable point behind every single mitzvah is that it is Hashem Himself, and that by us fulfilling it, we become one totally with Hashem. There's also a Maimer discourse from the Rebbe Rashab from Tafresh Nun Ches, Simchas Torah, Yehi Hashem Aleikeinu Imanu, which discusses this idea. See there. How, because God is Atzmut, He's the essence of everything, so therefore He is no closer to spirituality than to the physicality, and therefore He decides how we become close to Him. So as I said, this concept is broad and it sheds light on much of Judaism. But today I would like to say two small stories that come out of this that are related and that are very relevant. One story is, there was a rabbi, a Jew, his name was Herbert Weiner. He was a Reform rabbi, and he wrote a book called 9½ Mystics. And he was a very wise man. He wrote about the Rebbe, he wrote about Lubavitch, he wrote about spirituality. Later on in his life, he became much more observant. So in the late 50s, one time, he went into the Rebbe in Yechidus, and he asked the Rebbe, you know, people speak about the Bacharim, the students of Lubavitch, 770, Chassidim, they're very special. But you know, I looked at them, they look very simple. They look very plain. They have a certain naive look, open-eyed. I don't see what's so special about them. They actually look a bit weak and vulnerable. So the Rebbe said, you're missing something. And that is that their look of naivete is not coming from a weakness. It's not naivete, it's a wholesomeness. And the reason they have that wholesome look is because there's no split in their lives. There's no kera. And he says, you might have a kera in your life. Some people call it a dissonance. You know, there's a dissonance, there's a split. By one person, it means that the godly soul is not really having a positive impact on their animal soul enough. There's a division. There's a division, between man's desire and how much he's actually accomplishing. So the Rebbe told Herbert Weiner, you have a split, they don't have a split. Now the truth is everyone has some sort of split till Mashiach comes. But we don't have a general split, meaning to say, we have a centrality in our lives, something at the core, which gives a person meaning and purpose around which all else revolves. So let's talk about the spiritual and the physical. In the secular culture, there's always a problem when you have an artist and then he did something which is unbecoming, and then we have a question, could we still appreciate his art, etc., etc. In Judaism, when we talk about our role models, such a thing could not exist, because there would be no separation between the concept and the lifestyle. It becomes one. There's no split. There's a core, and that core is the foundation upon which all else is built and flows. So this is a very, very important idea. How in Judaism in general, there's no split. And then in the people that are living the life of Judaism, there is no split. The physical and the spiritual all go together. Then there's another very interesting story of art, which I like very much, which also brings out this idea, but in a different way. And that is, there was a famous Chassid, his name was the Rashbatz. He lived around 170 years ago. And he was a Chassid of the Tzemach Tzedek, the third Lubavitcher Rebbe. Anyways, there was once a farbrengen going on in his house, and it was late at night, and they were farbrengen for many hours, saying l'chaim, singing songs. And then the farbeisen ran out. The farbeisen is what you eat on the table. As you drink l'chaim, you take food into your mouth right after the drink. That's called farbeisen. So the farbeisen ran out, and they're sitting over there farbrengen. They're running dry, they're on empty. So they turn to the Rashbatz. The farbrengen was in his house. He says, oh, I have an idea. I have a lamb in the yard. Let's use the lamb. So, yeretum giton, they said, and they did it right away. They got the lamb. They had a sheikhet there. He shechted the lamb. They made a dish. They put it down on the table. And they had to what the farbrengen with fuel for the next couple hours. The next morning, Rebbitzin Rashbatz, the wife of the Rashbatz, gets up. She has a surprise. She walks out of the house and she sees there's no lamb. Where's the lamb? What happened to the lamb? The lamb disappeared. A bit like Rahman al-Sahn, your worst nightmare. You get up in the morning, go out of your house, and the car is not where you parked the car. Nightmare. So she's screaming, where's the lamb? What happened to the lamb? It's missing. It's gone. So Rashbatz tells her it's not gone. It's here. It's just making a different sound. Yesterday, the sound the lamb made was meh, meh. Today, the sound the lamb is making is echad. Echad. That's the story. He's telling his wife that the lamb was used in a Chassidic farbrengen. It was elevated and now became one with the body, with the people that were by this farbrengen. And today, as they lay Krishma and they say, Shema Yisrael, Hashem Echad, Hashem Elikinu, Hashem Echad, it's the fuel, it's the energy that they derived from the lamb that is now proclaiming Hashem's unity. So they took the lamb and it became elevated. So that's a chassid's perspective on life. Everything is Hashem. The physical and the spiritual all become one. The Ebishah should help that we should see the ultimate merging and unification of the spiritual and the physical in a revealed way. When Mashiach comes, as it says, V'nigla kved Hashem v'ro kol basar yachtav, the flesh will see the godliness. But our activity on the Sukkos is as much as possible to fulfill that in the proper way, with the ruchnis and the gashmis and the gashmis and the ruchnis become one, and we should see it mamish in the best possible way. Begula mitzvah shleima, take it from yad mamish. Good yontiv, posting from my home. Be'ez Hashem Yisbarech, your man in Melbourne.